Hi, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this EMS webinar. I am Maria Grazia De Angelis. I am the Vice President of the Society, and on behalf of the Council, I am very happy to introduce our lecturer today, who is Dr. Francesco Galliano. Today's topic is a very hot and interesting one. So he is going to talk about the sustainable membrane preparation. And before leaving the stage to him, I'm going to say a few words about his profile. Francesco received the degree in pharmacy from the University of Calabria in Italy, and later got his PhD in 2013. Since 2018, he has been working at the Institute on Membrane Technology at the National Research Council in Italy. And he is a permanent researcher there. He also got many prizes for his research activity, and in particular, he won the best oral presentation at the ICOM conference in 2021. And he was selected as, in 2014, while in 2021, he was selected as the winner of the Clean Technology Journal Young Investigator Award. He was also selected last year as a member of the Early Career Editorial Board of the Journal of Membrane Science. He has published something like 70 scientific articles in international journals. He also serves as editor in several journals or guest editor. And what is most interesting to say is that his research activity is about the preparation and characterization of polymeric membranes for water purification, both in the flat and hollow fiber configuration. And recently, he devoted his activity towards the replacement of traditional toxic solvents with greener alternatives for membrane preparation. So I hope I introduced you properly. Sorry for this.
Yes, thank you.
Francesco, and I leave the stage to you.
Yes, thank you very much, Maria Grazia, for your kind introduction. And also thanks to all of you for this kind invitation to hold this webinar today. As you said, this webinar will be focused on the recent research advances in the field of membrane preparation using a more sustainable and greener approaches. The concept of sustainability in membranes is strictly related to the concept of circular economy. Circular economy is an economic system of closed loops, and an ideal and a sustainable economy is one which is able to provide the greatest amount of well-being using the lowest amount of resources. The transition towards a sustainable economy is imperative now more than ever in order to face the current global problems, passing through the replacement of traditional chemicals, which can be toxic for human or harmful for the environment, with renewable, recyclable, and biodegradable materials. Circular economy is also related to the concept of sustainable development. This concept has been elaborated in 1987 by the World Commission of Environmental and Development. And the European Commission in particular sees the transition towards a circular economy as an opportunity to modernize and also to transform Europe, also following the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. The sustainable development concept is based also on the so-called 3R approach. This 3R approach helps to cut down on the amount of wastes we throw away by recycling, reusing, and reducing. As we all know that membrane processes can be considered as sustainable and environmentally friendly processes for different reasons. First of all, membranes, they do not need any chemicals to achieve the separation. They have a small footprint. They can rely on the use on modest energy consumption in comparison to other conventional separating technology. They have also a certain degree of flexibility, and they can be easily scaled up and integrated in other systems. However, the way the membranes are produced is not sustainable at all. So if from one side the membrane process itself can be considered sustainable, what is behind, what is before, which is membrane preparation, cannot be currently defined green and sustainable for different reasons. Above all, about the use of chemicals, solvents and polymers which are employed. Some years ago, Lawler and co-workers published on desalination a work where they carried out the life cycle assessment of a membrane reverse osmosis module in order to evaluating the environmental impact of of the production of this module, considering all the components of the module. So going from the outer casing to the membranes, of course, to the feed spacer, to the tubes, and so on. What they found out was that the membrane production was the major responsible of CO2 emission, considering all the components of the module, and in particular, due to the solvents and to the polymer employed for preparing these membranes, the membrane had an important impact on different parts of the environment. In particular, the ecotoxicity was mainly related to the use of DMF solvent, but also the production of membrane had an impact on marine and freshwater eutrophication and on fossil depletion for the use of the polymers which were employed. For preparing a membrane, a polymeric membrane, we know that we need a solvent, of course. The solvent is the major component in a DOPE solution, accounting for the 80 up to 90% of the whole DOPE solution. Traditional solvents employed in membrane preparation are N-methylpyrrolidone, dimethylformamide, dimethylacetamide. Then, of course, we have the polymers. We can have different types of polymers. Most common are fluorinated polymers, such as PVDF, or sulfonated polymers, such as polyether sulfone, or other polymers, such as polyacrylonitrile, and so on. And then we can have also some additives, such as PVP, which can be used as performers or to improve specific membrane properties. All these components, they have an impact on their sustainability. First of all, because most of the solvents, and in particular the solvents that I mentioned, they have a certain degree of toxicity. They can be harmful for the environment. They can also be ecotoxic. Moreover, most of the polymers which are employed, they are fossil-based, they are not biodegradable, so they can pose also problems for the end of life of the membrane. If we give a look to the production of chemicals in Europe, during the last years, chemicals which are defined as hazardous, we can see that the production of these chemicals is still massive. We are talking about of more than 70 million tons per year just in Europe, of solvents or chemicals in general, which can be considered, which have significant chronic, moderate or severe hazardousness for the environment. Also, if we give a look at the production of chemicals always in Europe, which pose risks for human health, we can see that their production is even more large. We are talking about more than 200 million of tons of chemicals, which are harmful for the health, toxic, very toxic, chronic, carcinogenic, mutagenic, reprotoxic. So, as we can see, there is an urgent need to find new chemicals, new compound, which are able to replace these chemicals and can be considered green and more benign. So, in order to achieve this transition, one approach can be to follow the so-called 12 principles of green chemistries, which were elaborated by Anastas and Warner. And in particular, specifically for membrane preparation, we can refer to the principle number 5. The principle number 5 states that the use of auxiliary substances, such as solvents, should be made unnecessary wherever possible and innocuous when used. For this reason, to be really sustainable, a membrane process should not involve the use of dangerous chemicals in the membrane production itself. But finding a solvent or a chemical which can be defined green is not easy at all. A chemical, in order to be defined green, should fulfill a series of requirements, and some of them are reported in this slide. First of all, it should be, of course, not toxic for human, not carcinogenic, not reprotoxic. Then it should be not toxic for the environment, so it should not contribute to the production of photochemical smog and ozone depletion, should be not toxic for the aquatic life, biodegradable, not containing ingredients that can cause eutrophication like phosphorus, and should be derived from natural raw materials. Then the chemical should be also safe, so not flammable, not explosive, and finally also should be easy to prepare. So it has to be prepared with a low energy requirement, with a high yield, and should have an easy waste disposal. So as you can see, finding a chemical which can respond to all these requirements is quite challenging. Moreover, once we identify a green chemical, in particular a green solvent for membranes, it's not easy to use it in membrane preparation. As I said before, the solvents which are currently employed in membrane preparation are N-methylpyrrolidone, DMA, DMF, THF, which somehow have a strong impact on the environment due to their hazardousness, or they can pose problems for human health. We have already available some solvents that can be defined green, such as styrene, polar clean, ethyl lactate, which have shown their potential to replace traditional solvents in membrane preparation. But replacing a solvent with another one is not an easy task in membranes. The reason is because the solvent is not just involved in the solubilization of the polymer, but the solvent plays also a crucial role in determining the final properties of the membrane, so the pore size, the porosity, the mechanical resistance. Here are listed some of the most common polymers which are employed in membrane preparation, because with the solvent, the polymer are, of course, the main components of DOP solution. And here we have a list of possible alternatives to traditional fossil-based polymers that can be used in membrane preparation, which are biopolymers. Biopolymers certainly have some important advantages in comparison to traditional polymers because they are biocompatible, most of them biodegradable. Of course, they are not toxic, so they don't pose this type of risks. However, the use of biopolymer in membrane preparation is quite challenging, first of all, because the mechanical properties of the membranes produced with these biopolymers can be a bottleneck. And these biopolymers often need to be blended with other polymers or with inorganic particles in order to have stable membranes. By the way, biopolymers are very well appreciated in some particular applications, like in the biomedical sector. In this presentation, we will go through, first of all, the use of solvents, which have been used for the preparation of membranes as alternative to traditional toxic solvent. We have a class of solvents which can be defined more sustainable, such as triethyl phosphate, dimethyl sulfoxide, or Tamisolve. They cannot be defined green, but certainly they are safer chemicals in comparison to other solvents. Then we have the solvents which can be defined green that have been successfully used for the preparation of membranes, such as polar clean, dimethyl isosorbide, styrene, gamma valerolactone. Then we will go to a case study where we prepared totally green membranes by combining a green solvent like styrene and a biopolymer. And finally, I will give an outlook on some of the new solvents which have been recently used for the preparation of membranes, like diphthotic solvents. So about the class of solvents which can be defined more sustainable, even if not totally green, we have triethyl phosphate. Triethyl phosphate is a solvent with a very good ecotoxicological profile. It's not considered toxic. Does not cause bioaccumulation in the human body, is just classified as irritant. Triethyl phosphate is not green, and we can easily understand the reason by looking at the chemical structure, because it has an atom of phosphorus in the chemical structure. So, of course, phosphorus can cause problems to the environment, like eutrophication or cause problems to aquatic life. However, even if not green, this solvent can be a safer alternative to other common solvents. In our group, we used this solvent for the preparation of membranes in PVDF using NIPS-VIPS process and using polyethylene glycol and PVP as additives. Usually, when we identify a new possible green solvent candidate, first of all, we analyze the Hansen solubility parameters in order to predict what can be the polymers that this new solvent is able to solubilize. So this is very useful for us to understand what we can do with this solvent. If we give a look to the Hansen solubility parameter of triethyl phosphate, we immediately notice that they are very similar to traditional solvents, to DMF, DMA, and MP. And in fact, the Hansen solubility parameters well predict the possibility to solubilize PVDF, which is soluble in this traditional solvent, also in triethylphosphate. For this reason, we were able to prepare membranes. Of course, we changed different parameters. In particular, we used two different coagulation baths, ethanol and water. And as you can see from SEM images, we were able to get different morphologies. A sponge-like structure in case ethanol was used as a coagulation bath, an asymmetric finger-like structure when water was used as a coagulation bath. So basically the morphology, the architecture of the membrane is related to the solvent, non-solvent exchange rate during membrane formation. With water, which is a stronger non-solvent, of course, is faster, this exchange. So finger-like or microvoid structures are generally preferred. And we also evaluated the impact of the use of an additive, polyethylene glycol, a different concentration on the structure of the membranes. And as expected, the addition of polyethylene glycol promoted the formation of a more porous structure in the microfiltration range. So another interesting solvent and also very popular solvent is dimethyl sulfoxide. Dimethyl sulfoxide is one of the strongest organic solvent, fully miscible with water, and this is an advantage because in membrane preparation, because if a solvent is miscible with water, you can use NIPS technique for inducing the exchange between water used as a coagulation bath and the solvent used for polymer solubilization. It has a high boiling point. It has a low level of toxicity. It is environmentally friendly. However, DMSO can be considered as a more sustainable solvent, but also in this case is not completely green. We employed DMSO for the production of membrane in polyether sulfone using PEG and PVP as additives. Here are shown some SEM images. Also in this case, we were able to get different morphologies, but this time we played on the exposure time of the cast film to humidity. In fact, the membranes prepared by NIPS, so the membrane that were immediately coagulated after casting, they showed a denser top layer and a microvoid structure along the cross-section, while when the cast film was exposed to a humid environment before coagulation, a much porous surface was obtained and a sponge-like morphology along the cross-section was visible. Tamisolve is another more sustainable solvent. The chemical name is N-butylpyrrolidone, and as you can see from the chemical structure and also as the name suggests, it is very similar to NMP, N-methylpyrrolidone. But butylpyrrolidone is much safer from a toxicological point of view. Tamisolve has been used for the preparation of PVDF copolymer membranes in our group in 2017. Also in this case, by changing some parameters, we were able to tune the morphology of the membrane. And we also applied the membranes that we got, that were microfiltration membrane, in membrane distillation by comparing the results with polypropylene membranes, which are we used as a benchmark. And we noticed that the performance of the membranes prepared with Tamisolve are comparable respect to the membranes prepared in polypropylene. So even if the solvent has an impact in plays a role in determining the morphology or size of a membrane, of course, the membrane, the final membrane properties are still kept. Now we start with the list of solvents which can be defined greener or green. Here we have PolarClean. PolarClean is the trade name of methyl 5 dimethylammino 2 methyl 5 oxopentanoate. PolarClean can be synthesized by a bioproduct produced during the synthesis of nylon 66. So can be obtained through the valorization of a bioproduct, which is usually which is not useful during the production of nylon. If we give a look to the Hansen solubility parameter of PolarClean reported in this table in comparison to the other traditional solvents, we can see that they are very similar. And also, if we calculate the distance between the solvent PolarClean and polyether sulfone, we see that the value is 2.3, so it's a very small value. It means that this solvent has an higher affinity for the polymer. For this reason, in fact, polyether sulfone is soluble, well soluble in PolarClean. In this table, I reported the chemical physical properties of PolarClean in comparison to other solvents. We can see that PolarClean is a not volatile solvent. It has a very high boiling point, so it allows also the preparation of membranes by thermally induced phase separation, and as a risk phases. PolarClean is just irritant, so it's not of course toxic, reprotoxic or mutagenic. PolarClean was used for the preparation of PES membranes like the ones you can see in STM pictures without additives and with some pore forming additives. Without additives, we obtained this particular structure, asymmetric structures, where the membranes were prepared by NIPS or by VIPS NIPS. So there was not a great difference in morphology independently of the technique employed. We got a denser surface and a finger-like cross-section. But when we added PVP and polyethylene glycol as additives, we can see that the morphology, the overall morphology of the membrane totally changed. In particular, when we employed the VIPS, we were able to produce membrane with an higher porosity and also pore size, and this time with a sponge-like structure. Dimethyl isosorbide is another solvent. This time we are talking about a green solvent. Dimethyl isosorbide was used for the first time in 2019 from our group for the preparation of membranes. Dimethyl isosorbide is currently used in as additive in pharmaceutical formulations, in personal care products, and in cosmetic. If we give a look to the ecotoxicological profile of dimethyl isosorbide, we can see that is practically non-toxic, is not, of course, carcinogenic, non mutagenic, not reprotoxic, it has not oral acute toxicity, is not genotoxic, it does not cause bioaccumulation in human body, is not irritating for the skin. So as you can see, dimethyl isosorbide is a very safe solvent. Moreover, another interesting aspect which makes dimethyl isosorbide green is represented by its synthesis. This is very important because in order to be defined green, a chemical should be not only not toxic and not harmful for the environment, but also the synthesis, the way how this solvent, this chemical is produced, should be green. And very recently, it has been demonstrated that dimethyl isosorbide can be synthesized starting from cellulose, which can be converted in a sugar, in sorbitol, which can be converted using dimethyl carbonate as a solvent both acting both as a solvent and as a reagent in isosorbide, which can be finally converted in dimethyl isosorbide. All this synthesis can run on green chemicals. We employed, as I said, the dimethyl isosorbide for the preparation of membranes. We explored two polymers, polyether sulfone and PVDF, and we prepared membranes by using VIPS NIPS technique. Here are some of the results that we got. In particular, we were able to tune the pore size of PVDF and PES membranes from ultrafiltration to microfiltration range by just acting on the exposure time of the cast film to a humid environment. So we often play with humidity because it gives us the possibility to tune the membrane pore size without adding other additives, other performers. We also fully characterized the membranes also from the mechanical point of view and water permeability, and we obtained very stable and reproducible membranes. Cyrene is another green solvent. Cyrene can be obtained from levoglucosenone, hydrogenation of levoglucosenone, which can be produced starting from cellulose. Also for cyrene, if we analyze the health and safety properties, we can see that cyrene is not reprotoxic, not mutagenic, is just irritant for eyes. It is almost fully biodegradable, can be biodegraded in 14 days, and it is barely ecotoxic. Cyrene has been employed by us for the preparation, also in this case, of PS and PVDF membranes. In case of PS, as you can see from the SEM pictures, basically we got membranes characterized by a microvoid structure along the cross-section, while in case of PVDF, the sponge-like morphology was predominant. This was mainly related to thermodynamic and kinetic parameters entering into play during membrane formation, and linked to the different viscosity of the DOPS solutions prepared in PS respect to PVDF, and also to the different affinity of cyrene to PS respect to PVDF. Another interesting solvents, which are now using, but it's already, some works are already available in literature on the use of this solvent for membrane preparation, is gamma-valerolactone. Gamma-valerolactone can be obtained from lignocellulose, from lignin, which is a constituent of the plants. It's a good solvent for PVDF. And we are at the moment using this solvent for preparing PVDF membranes with different morphologies and different pore sizes. As I said at the beginning, in order to achieve 100% sustainability in membrane preparation, not only is important not only the solvent that should be not toxic, safe, and so on, but also the use of polymer. So the ideal should be combining a green solvent with a biopolymer. Of course, not always this is possible because basically depends on the application, final application of the membrane. But in this work, in the work that I'm going to show, we produced membranes, fully sustainable membranes, employing cyrene as a green solvent and a polymer belonging to the class of polyhydroxyalkanoates as biopolymer. Basically, biopolymers and plastic can be classified in four different groups. on the basis of their biodegradability and on the basis of their source. So in the first group, we have the polymers, the materials, which are not biodegradable and fossil-based, such as polypropylene or polyethylene. Then in the second group, we have the polymers, which are biodegradable and bio-based, such as PHA, PLA, and cellulose. And here in this category, to this category belongs PHA, which is the polymer that we employed in this work. Then in the third group, we have the polymers, which are fossil-based, but biodegradable, such as polycaprolactone. And finally, in the last group, we have the polymers, which are bio-based, but not biodegradable, such as bio-PET or bio-polyethylene. So, as I said, the polymer, the biopolymer that we employed in this work belongs to the family of polyhydroxyalkanoates, which are linear polyesters resistant to water, so they are not soluble in water. They are biodegradable, renewable, biocompatible. They can be produced in nature by fermentation of bacteria, fermentation of sugar. And in particular, we used a particular type of PHA, which is PHB, polyhydroxybutyrate, which is the most common type. This work has been carried out in collaboration with the University of Rennes in France, which provided us the biopolymer. And also we did, together in collaboration with them, the preparation of the membranes. PHA are in general well used in some sectors, such as food packaging. And we employed, in combination with a green solvent, which is styrene, for the preparation of membranes. We explored the possibility to include in the DOP solution different additives, starting from the fossil-based PVP, which is a quite traditional additive, but also using other two additives, more sustainable, more green, such as polyethylene glycol, and a new additive, also in this case, that was already explored by the French colleague for the blending with this type of biopolymer, which is the epoxidized broccoli oil. This biopolymer, this additive can be obtained from broccoli beans, and it was demonstrated to improve the mechanical properties of the polymer and of the final membrane. Why we selected styrene as a green solvent? Also in this case, as I said at the beginning, first of all, we evaluate the Hansen solubility parameters of the polymer and of different solvents. And we try to identify which can be the best solvent for that given polymer. In this case, styrene theoretically was a good solvent for this type of solvent. And also when we did the test, styrene was a very good solvent for solubilizing PHB. Here is the list of all the membranes we prepared and all the variables that we evaluated. I will not go, of course, in the detail of all the membranes produced and all the variables that we investigated, but just to mention some results, in case when we used we prepared membranes by using just biopolymer and solvent, we got membrane asymmetric membranes made of a dense top layer and a spherulitic structure visible along the cross section. This was mainly independent on the evaporation time, because we prepared membranes by casting the solution, polymer solution, at 130 degrees, and we evaluated the different evaporation time of this cast film before being coagulated in water. In this case, by using just polymer and solvent, we the morphology, the surface of the membranes was pore, was dense in all cases. But when we used additives, PVP, PEG, or the epoxidized broccoli oil, the situation changed. We were able to induce the formation of a certain degree of porosity on the membrane and pores, which were mainly in the ultrafiltration range. And here are listed some of the characterization tests we carried out. And also the porosity of the membrane was quite good, around 70%. We also, since when you work with a biopolymer, you have to be careful that the membrane, the final application of the membrane will be tested in an application where the mechanical properties of the membrane will not be compromised. And of course, in such condition, where the biopolymer is not biodegraded. So in our case, we incubated the membranes for more than 3 months in seawater or using an enzymatic lipase solution in order to evaluate the resistance of the membranes towards these conditions. And in 3 months, we just observed a weight loss of the membrane of less than 5%, testifying that under these conditions, the membranes were stable. Moreover, we applied the dense membranes, the membranes with a dense surface, in pervaporation for the organic-organic separation of methanol from methyl terbutylether. And we found that not only the membranes were stable when in contact with this organic-organic solution, even for long period of times, but the membranes were also selective, in this case for methanol, giving also good values of selectivity. So if green solvent, we are saying that green solvent have all these beneficial features, and with this work, we can somehow demonstrate that membranes can be actually prepared using green solvents. What are the main bridles which does not allow at the moment a full exploitation also at the industrial scale of these green solvents? We have to say that things are generally changing because of the national and international restrictions about the use of some solvents. For sure, in the near future, we'll move the production to more and more sustainable and green solvents. Another aspect, by the way, an aspect that has to be, of course, considered is the cost of these solvents. In this table, I listed the cost of euro per liter of traditional green solvents. The cost refers to Sigma-Aldrich, to Merck. And some of them, they are quite expensive, still quite expensive, such as styrene, but other solvents, the costs can be comparable to traditional solvents or can be in some cases lower. But of course, the a wider use of this solvent in general will make the cost in the future lower. Finally, in the last slides of this presentation, I will just show new trends in the preparation of membranes, new solvents, which have been very recently explored for the preparation of polymeric membranes, which are represented by DS, diprotetic solvents. DS are a mixture of chemicals, let's say. They are very easy to be synthesized. They can be synthesized with a low cost from natural also materials. In this case, we talk about NADES. They have a good thermal stability, high tunability. Also, they are environmentally friendly. It can be recyclable. And also, if we give a look at the number of publications in general, so not only related to membranes, on the use of DES in the last years, we can see that the trend is increasing, showing the great interest of the scientific community on the use of this kind of solvents. We used DS, different kind of DS, in a very recent work just published. So we used the halogen-free Brosten acidic DS, or sulfobeta in based DS, or NADES, which are naturally based DS. And we employed for the solubilization of two polymers. One of the main limitations to using this type of DS is their very high viscosity, which does not allow to completely solubilize the polymer or to cast the DOP solution. For this reason, in order to overcome this issue, we added small quantities of other green or more sustainable solvents in the DOP solution, such as polyacrylene, TEP, triethyl phosphate, and dimethyl sulfoxide, in order to make the DOP solution less viscous. And we investigated the preparation of membranes using two polymers, PVDF and polyacrylonitrile, by using NIPS technique. Of course, we also selected the DS and the polymers based always on the Hansen solubility parameters. So we carried out preliminary theoretical calculation in order to predict which DS could be used for solubilizing given polymers. And these are the structures of some membranes that we got in PVDF and polyacrylonitrile. So we were able to produce mechanically stable membranes, and this was not easy. It was quite challenging. We worked actually more than 2 years in order to produce stable membranes, to find the proper composition of DOP solution, and also preparation conditions. And we got different morphologies and membranes with a pore size in the range of ultrafiltration and microfiltration. So here are the conclusions. So we can say that until now, many efforts have been done in order to make membrane fabrication more sustainable and greener, in particular, replacing traditional toxic solvents with greener alternatives. It's very useful at the beginning when you identify a new potential green solvent to evaluate the Hansen solubility parameters, because they can give a good indication of the solubility of traditional polymers or biopolymers in the new solvent. A series of green solvents, such as styrene, dimethyl isosorbide, are already available, and they are already being proved to efficiently work in preparing membranes with different morphology, with good mechanical properties, and that can be used in different applications. Moreover, in order to make the overall preparation process, membrane preparation process, fully sustainable, we need also to try to replace traditional petroleum-derived polymers with biopolymers, also making blending, so using biopolymer and traditional polymers, because this will strongly contribute to the development of fully green membranes. So that's all, and thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you, Francesco, for this. So before we start to...
Maria Grazia, I cannot hear you very well. Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, now yes.
Okay. Okay, so thank you for the presentation, and it was really broad and comprehensive. And while we wait for the questions from the audience, I invite the audience to type questions on the YouTube chat. I have a question. You made...
Maria Grazia?
Okay.
Marietta, sorry, you lost the connection because I didn't hear your question.
I don't know. Maybe yes, I was kicked out of the room.
Okay.
So my question is, in order to reduce the trial and errors that you have to perform experimentally, do you envision any alternative solutions, such as based on design of experiments, thermodynamic modeling, machine learning, to reduce the number of experiments that you have to do to find the optimal protocol, the optimal solvent polymer combination, composition, operative conditions, and so on?
Yeah, all the approaches that you mentioned, machine learning or modeling, can be very useful in order to reduce the number of trials. Because you're right, when you explore a new chemical in membrane preparation, theoretically you need a lot of trials because you don't know how this new solvent in particular behave with the polymers and under which condition you can solubilize. So all these methods can be very useful. What we really find useful are also, as I said, the thermodynamic studies, basing also, taking from literature the Hansen solubility parameter of the new solvent and comparing the Hansen solubility parameter of the new solvent with the traditional solvent. If they are similar, this is a quite good indication that the solvent can work with the polymers generally employed. And also calculating by Hansen solubility parameters the distance between solvent and polymer can give also a good indication on a prediction, good prediction of the solubility. Then, of course, you can do also some with modeling and machine learning. You can somehow also predict which can be the best polymer concentration to be used, the temperature. You can, make the range of trials smaller, but at a certain time, of course, the experimental tests are, at the end are fundamental in order to okay. identify the optimal conditions.
Thank you. I think we have some questions from the audience. Babar asking you whether we can use water as a solvent to fabricate membranes for perforation.
Of course, there are some polymers that are soluble in water. I was thinking about ketosan. Ketosan, for instance, is soluble in water with addition of acetic acid, 2%. The problem is that basically you have somehow cross-link these polymers. Ketosan, for instance, can be used, is water soluble, let's say, it's soluble in acidic water, can be used in evaporation, but you need to cross-link. So you need to do a cross-linking in order to strengthen the mechanical properties of the final membrane. And in particular, we used ketosan cross-linked membranes for organic-organic separation. So yes, for ketosan, you can use water as a solvent and you can prepare dense films and you can use impervaporation, but you need cross-linking. And in the concept of sustainability, you have to think about that you are using a biopolymer, which is ketosan, so good. You use a green solvent, the best green solvent, which is water, so good. But the cross-linking can be problematic from the sustainable point of view because you need glutaraldehyde, which is carcinogenic. There are some other alternative cross-linking agents which can be explored or can be used more natural, such as genipin. So you need to go in this direction if you're aim is to produce fully sustainable membranes.
Okay, thanks a lot. I think the question was answered. Okay, the other questions from Patrick. What will be the impact of replacing the solvents by greener ones on the recycling of solvents from member fabrication?
Okay, some of the green solvents can be easily recovered by distillation. It depends, of course, on the boiling point. For instance, Polar Clean has a very high boiling point, almost 300 degrees. So if you prepare membranes with Polar Clean by nips, then at the end, your solvent will exchange in the water coagulation bath, so you will have the solvent diluted in water. In this case, you can easily recover Polar Clean by distillation, because of course you evaporate water at 100 degrees, and the Polar Clean, it has a very much higher boiling point at 300 degrees almost, so you can easily separate the mixture and recover and recycle your solvent. From a sustainability point of view, this is very, very beneficial to recover and reuse the solvent. So, of course, some of green solvents like Polar Clean can well respond to also to the to this aspect. So they can be recycled by distillation. Yeah.
Yeah, so just as a comment to the previous question, maybe pervaporation can be an alternative for solvent recovery.
Yeah, of course, also pervaporation can be an alternative, in particular when you want to evaporate, the solvent create with water anisotropic mixture. So maybe you can separate with traditional distillation until a certain concentration. Then you reach a concentration where your solvent and water form an anisotrope. In that case, you cannot use any more distillation, but you can use pervaporation, of course. So you can use, if you want to remove water, you can use an hydrophilic membrane. If you need to remove an organic solvent, you can use an hydrophobic membrane. But of course, yes, pervaporation can be used. Yeah, it can help to break the azeotrope and separate the solvent from the coagulation bath.
Okay, there is another question. Can the membranes made with green solvents be used for filtering water and make it safe to drink?
Yes, why not? Yeah, of course. First of all, you have to consider that the main issue, let's say, it's to prepare with the new green solvent stable membranes with the desired morphology and pore size. Once you are able to produce the membranes with the desired pore size and the desired porosity and morphology, of course, then the membranes is made just of the polymer at the end. So the solvent will not be present anymore, because then the solvent will be totally removed during membrane formation, or removed afterwards by washing the membrane or extracting the possible solvent traces. So, of course, the membranes can be safely used for water treatment. Yes, the solvent does not pose any problem on this regard. And you can, above all, in this scenario, you are using a safer solvent. So, if it is valid for traditional solvents, which are used for preparing membrane for filtering water, it is much more valid for this green solvent.
Okay. I think that we are running out of time. I don't see any other questions from the audience. Just lots of congratulations to you, Francesco, for this impressive work. And join me, please, in thanking Francesco Gagliano again for his very interesting contribution. And I ask the audience to subscribe to our YouTube channel, of course. And the next webinar is fixed for the beginning of April. We normally have our webinars the first Wednesday of the month. So stay tuned and see you next time. And thank you,
Francesco,
again.
Thank you, Maria Grazia. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.